across our country, as well as here in our community, because of officer-involved shootings and the families that have been impacted by those shootings, leaving them mourning their loss and emotionally scarred, and requiring the support of community coming together. So we are here asking that others in our community will continue to stand with this family as we stand with others all across our country, so that they can know that they are not alone.
Amen.
So we are grateful for we are grateful for the leadership of Senator Rhonda Fields, that is one of our senior advocates in one of our senior advocates supporting the support for this family. And we're going to ask that her daughter, Maisha Fields, would come at this time to read a statement. Following that, we have two other statements that will be read from city council members who are also showing their advocacy for this issue and for this family. So I'm going to ask if Maisha would come at this time.
Thank you, Pastor Dale. First, giving honor to Brandon Cole and to Ms. Ebony Cole. This press conference has only been going on for about 60 seconds. It took Denver PD 46 seconds to get out of a car and kill her husband after she specifically said, "Don't hurt my husband."
That's right.
Senator Rhonda Fields wanted me to give this very brief analysis. This is a marker. This is a knife.
Yes, sir.
The size is different.
Yes, it is.
The length is different.
Uh-huh.
The colors are different.
Talk.
Regardless of what happened when Brandon Cole went to the car, this is a marker.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is a knife.
This is a knife. Talking here, talking.
And we should never rush
That's right.
to murder or to kill.
That's right. That's right.
And so with that, I want to read Senator Fields' statement. Give me just 1 second as I pull it up. One thing we know today is that Brandon Cole should be alive.
Yes.
Police officers are trained to protect and serve. Their first reaction when they arrive to a scene of a crime should never be to shoot to kill or to murder. There should be more options available, and they are available based on the legislation that I passed. These are the words of Senator Rhonda Fields from Senate Bill 217. I am asking, I am demanding and requiring that the Denver Police Department be more accountable, be more transparent, and do the job that they were called to do when they took the oath to serve and to protect.
Yeah, yeah.
Black people should not be hunted in our own communities.
That's right, that's right.
When we seek your help, you should show up with help and with other individuals who can address behavioral health and mental health issues.
Yes.
We will not rest until there is justice for Brandon Cole, his family, and his children.
Yes.
No child should be left alone without their mother or father due to gun violence.
That's
enough
right.
is enough.
Yeah, yeah, thank you, Senator.
These are the words of Senator Rhonda.
Thank you, Senator. Yeah, yeah.
This is a marker.
Amen.
And this
is a knife.
Is a knife.
That's you said it, something right there. Talk, Reverend. Amen. Yeah.
Thank you.
Well said, well said.
Thank you, Maisha, and we are also grateful and thankful for the written statement from Senator Rhonda Fields. I'm going to ask at this time if those representatives from City Council, if you are present now, if you'll make your way here to the platform so that you can read your statements at this time and let us know who you're representing.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
My name is Ashley Wedgeworth, and I am here on behalf of Denver City Councilwoman Chantel Lewis.
Yeah. Woo! Woo!
All right.
It is with a heavy heart that we have to return time and again to this conversation. Brandon Lee Cole should be alive today. Our community mourns another life lost because of an armed officer acting as judge, jury, and executioner. In fewer than 60 seconds, officers arriving at the scene of a call have pulled their weapons, threatening to fire upon a man while calling the maneuver de-escalation. I don't know about you, but having a gun pointed at me would not bring a feeling of calm nor clarity. In fact, I have been by DPD, and calm was not what I experienced, but fear. As a mother, I'm haunted by the thought of my son, an artist and another kind soul, finding himself in a similar situation, unsure how to react and fearing for his life. In the limited body cam footage that has been released, we can all see that as his wife begged for his life, officers continued to heighten the tension around Brandon, having already decided that he was dangerous and deadly for holding a magic marker. It has been frustrating in the months since this horrific event to see our city's police force resist an honest and transparent conversation about accountability. As our city navigates our budget this week, it is plain to see that our funds are spread thin where life is made most beautiful. Our parks, our arts, our neighborhood hearts. Instead, we see millions of dollars being paid to victims of police violence. Already, a third of our city's budget is dedicated to policing, including Mayor Johnston proposing more than $8 million to be used for hiring 167 new officers. With so many questions remaining about whether new officers are being put on the street, armed, but without suitable training, oversight, and lacking a clear line of accountability, one has to ask, is this the best use of our taxpayers' dollars? Is our public safer when this is what public safety looks like? And I am also going to read a statement from at-large City Councilwoman Sarah Parity. Our city failed Brandon Lee Cole and his family. I am devastated, angry, and as an elected official, determined to do whatever is needed to stop deaths of unarmed black men at our hands. Thank you.
That's it.
We have another city council representative present. All right, at this time we're going to have Pastor Reginald Holmes. He's going to come with his comments and remarks at this time.
Good morning to everyone. I have a very long history with these kinds of police shootings. 2002, I was president of the Greater Metro Denver Ministerial Alliance when a similar situation occurred with Paul Childs, a young developmentally disabled young man who had a knife in his hand. A policeman infringed upon what they called the 21-foot rule. He saw the knife clearly, and he shot and killed Paul in the doorway of his mother's home. We are tired, to say the least, as a community. We're tired of being called to protect and serve when we have people whose job it is to protect and serve. It is extremely difficult to keep coming to these incidents of shootings of unarmed black and brown people. There seems to me to be two obvious tracks of training. There's one track of training that has an overwhelming sensitivity to white suspects. And then there is another training that does not have the same empathy for blacks and brown people.
That's right.
The two tracks of training must disappear and must go away. We must have the same response for black and brown people from our officers that they have for white suspects.
Yes, sir.
We all know that there are two tracks of training. We know that we don't have to look far in order to see it. For when Aurora had its mass shooting. We all know the results of James Holmes and what happened to him. He had a weapon.
Yes.
Right, yes.
There was no oops.
Right.
I thought he had a weapon.
Right.
Why is it that black and brown people are always the victims of the oops? I thought he had a weapon. When clearly, when weapons are seen, when weapons are possessed by white perpetrators,
that's right,
that somehow they don't get the same treatment,
that's right,
as black people.
Right. You talking, Reverend?
Now we don't want to play up here.
Don't play up
and
here.
Pretend as though we don't see it.
We see it, Reverend.
It happens too many times. Repeatedly.
Yes, sir.
To black and brown people. That that portion of the training that says, "Oops, I thought he had a gun."
Wow. Right.
We have to eliminate that. I'm here to support this family. I'm here to, as one who I have not seen the video, but how important is that when we know that the victim did not have a weapon?
Didn't have a weapon.
That's right.
Didn't have a weapon.
So anything that we want to say, anything that the department wants to say about we followed the rules, we followed protocol, then there's something very imperfect about your protocol and your training.
Right.
If at the end of the day, an innocent, unarmed black man was killed.
Wow.
There's something wrong with your training.
Yeah.
And so you're going to have to, Chief Thomas, we're going to have to do something about the training. The training is going to have to include some common sense, some empathy. There has to be equity in the sense that the same way we treat white suspects and white folks who have issues, we've got to treat black folk and brown people the same way. We can call the names, Jessica Hernandez, Ron Keel, Shannon Wright. We can call the roll because we all know that this only happens to black and brown people. Thank you.
Well said, Reverend. Well said, Reverend.
Thank you very much, Pastor Holmes.
Thank you.
We appreciate the support that he also lends and brings to the family, as well as continued insight into this issue. There were several voices from our community that spoke out on this issue within the time frame of August 5th. And we have some of those voices featured here today to come and to connect with all of us as community, to restate some of the things that they have shared already, and just to affirm their support for this family. So we are very appreciative to Dr. Lisa Calderon, who is here with us. She has recently been one of our mayoral candidates for our city, has widespread recognition across our community. I was very inspired and intrigued on the article that was featured in Denver Right that captured her essence about this issue. So I want you to welcome her to the microphone at this time.
I appreciate the invitation to come today and speak here. My heart is very heavy. This is absolutely the worst nightmare of any mother, of any wife, of any sister in our community. Many people don't know that my run for office was sparked by my activism around the police, Denver police brutality of my son when he was 15 years old, walking home from East High School and assaulted. And when he asked to talk to his mother, as I have trained him, as many black mothers have trained our black sons,
yes, yes,
to ask for a parent to be present with you when you need help, he was mocked. He was made fun of. Now that was 17 years ago, and I could not get justice for my son then. So I started engaging in politics to get someone to listen to me, that our children and our elders and everybody in between those ages were being mistreated, were being brutalized by a force that was supposed to serve and protect us. Mm-hmm. Paul Childs was murdered in his home, also a teenage black boy, in mental distress in 2003, 20 years ago, and was killed when his family called and asked for help. What have we learned in those 20 years? Well, one of the things I am clear on, and one of the platforms that I ran on, is that this institution of policing, which has its roots in slavery, cannot be reformed. We cannot train our way out of this. We need to fundamentally and systematically change the way that we define safety in our communities. And it is not with more police. So I have a very clear message from Mayor Mike Johnston, who I reluctantly endorsed as a harm reduction strategy to protect our communities. Your budget does not reflect the moral values of a city document, which is often attributed to Dr. Martin Luther King, that our budget is a moral document.
Yes.
When you are putting more money into more police, and not one dime into our proposal for an Office of Neighborhood Safety, which is about alternatives to policing, that we know works, that we know keeps our community safe. Not one dime.
Not one.
You're spending or proposing to spend $2 million for pickleball. Mm. Do you know what our community could do with $2 million?
All right.
We could set up that Office of Neighborhood Safety, rely on evidence-based practices, lobby for more mental health services and intervention.
Yes.
We know our community next.
Yes.
And I do want to give props to Giannina Horton with the Denver Justice Project, who was also quoted in that article, that when we're told that an officer is de-escalating and they don't understand that their very uniform is triggering, that means we need alternatives to calm our own community down. So I want to extend my deepest condolences to the family and let them know that I will stand with them. I will continue to pursue justice, including in that budget that we all have to fight for, because it's not final yet. And so I would ask you to join me to demand that Mayor Johnston include a budget line item for the Office of Neighborhood Safety.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Calderon. Before I bring up our next voice, just want to reframe why we are here. I want to make sure this remains in context, because people will have different opinions about what you might see on the public video of this encounter, of what happened on August 5th. Before you start to dissect all the details and start to try to determine an opinion about what caused what, at the end of the video, what we have to frame is the loss of life.
Period.
That's right.
It doesn't matter.
Period.
How did it happen?
That's right.
It doesn't matter who was responsible for making it happen. The problem is Brandon Cole lost his life.
Yes.
What brings this coalition of people together is not a debate or a discussion about how we should point the finger at which person directly is only responsible. Our greater focus right now is how do we support a family that now has to suffer and adjust. Everybody say adjust.
Adjust. Adjust.
I know we're not at church, but I'm a pastor. Everybody say adjust. We have been adjusting to what was required to supposedly make us safe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Talk to your children. Tell them what they should do when they encounter someone from law enforcement. Mm-hmm. We have been adjusting when we have been told to make sure that you don't walk these streets by yourself. Make sure there's someone who's accompanying you. We have adjusted, even moving out of certain known neighborhoods to move into neighborhoods where we think we might be safe. Perhaps the Brandon Cole neighborhood was supposed to be safer when you dial 911 because you know you're not coming to what is traditionally the hood. You know you're coming to a place where residents are supposed to be safe.
Talk, Reverend.
We have adjusted.
Made off adjustment.
But perhaps as it has already been inferred, the next adjustments need to be made so that any person from law enforcement can tell the difference between a weapon and a person not being armed. That adjustment should not be the responsibility of any potential suspect, because we shouldn't have to go to training to figure out as a citizen how not to look like I am a potential suspect or that my life should be in danger. So the adjustments that need to be made need to be made with those who have the power to take life away. That cannot go unframed. We are here because of the loss of Brandon Cole. We're going to ask that our city father, Bishop Asen Phillips, would come to the platform so that he can share his comments and remarks at this time.
Thank you so much, Pastor Dell, and to all those who shared before me. It's amazing how we are so articulate about what the problem is. And I love the way Pastor Dell framed it. The real problem is not what happened, nor how it happened, but why it happened. And to be very frank, one of the main reasons it happened, because Brandon happened to be black. And sometimes we're afraid to see that.
That's right.
We try to act like there's a colorless line. You got to be black specific. I don't care where you move to. Wherever you move, your black face goes with you. And somebody got to understand that it's all right to be black. You can't target us because of our color. Brandon is dead because he happened to be black. And when you look at it, all around the state, all around the nation, it keeps on happening. And then what really irritates me more than that is the response from the folk who killed him. Then they put a narrative out there that he's killed in this new process, caught by suicide. Let me help them. Suicide is against the law. Suicide is self-murder. So let's change it and say what you said. He was murdered by a cop. Because the cop thought he wanted to die. Young man suffering with medical challenges. Never been in conflict with the law as we know it. Taking care of a wife and three children. And with his medical problems, still the father in the home. My question is, why did you take your gun out in the first place? Nobody else had a gun. Nobody else even had a knife. He had to go get the pencil. And you mean to tell me you threatened by a pencil?
Come on, dog.
Two cops, one on one side, one on the other side. Got all kind of weapons. You could have used the billy club and hit him in the leg. But the story says you shot him with a taser first.
Yeah, yeah.
The taser didn't work. Is that Brandon's fault because the taser didn't work? You shoot him a second time in the arm. Now he can't even write with the pistol he got. But you decide after you shot him, with a taser after you shot him in the arm, you choose to shoot him in the heart. That's not an accident. That's murder. Now, anyway, you can frame it, he's dead by murder. The question now is how do we respond? Yeah. It bothers me that they want black folk now to agree with them to say it's death caused by suicide. I can't get that in my mouth.
No, sir. No, sir.
I don't know how to say that.
No, sir.
I don't know how to say this young man struggling with medical conditions and trying to obey the law, wanted to die.
No.
What that really says to us, when you look at a black face from your blue uniform, you say, black folk want to die.
Wow.
That's a lie. Black folk want to live.
Yeah.
We struggle to live.
Yeah.
Come through slavery, second class citizenship. We come through for in this city. You wouldn't have Elisa Calderon where she is if she didn't have the guts to come through the struggle that she is. Reginald Holmes, almost 20 plus years ago, we had the same situation. We set up a system and put some money aside to take care of mental challenges.
Wow.
We need to take care of this family. Thank God for the strength that this mother has. Now she's got to take care of the three children by herself.
Wow.
And somebody got to hear her voice. I want to say to all of us, the black community, the white community, the red community, pink polka dot, pink flag community, we got to all come together. Because what's happening to black folk now is going to happen to you in a minute. And look, God knows the system has to change. We got to stop trying to adjust. I don't need to make any more adjustments. The system needs to change. What's wrong is the process that says we got to kill it. Trained to shoot center mass.
Yes.
My God, today. Trained to kill folks.
Trained.
Trained to make sure you kill them if they happen to be black.
White, make sure
you gotta make sure you do that. Now, if you're white, you can have all kind of guns.
Yes.
You can shoot people in a theater, shoot them in a carbine. That's right here in our city. But if you're black trying to walk home, we're in the court right now. You know, man trying to walk home, just trying to get home.
Yeah.
And shot him and killed him. God knows. We have come too far in Colorado,
right.
Made too many progressive stands to go backwards now. We got a black police chief, got a black sheriff. Somebody might want to try to get rid of him. No, 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 we can keep what we want. If the police chief didn't shoot nobody,
wow.
Sheriff didn't shoot nobody,
wow.
A white woman shot the man and killed him.
Wow.
You got to focus on who did the damage. The system would say, let's change the leader. Ain't nothing wrong with that. Black chief, I guarantee you, I've known him since he was a young man. He wants to do the right thing. There's a girl over there in the DA department named Beth McCann. I think she wants to do the right thing. And this group, we have to give them the power to do the right thing. Make sure you examine and take it closer. Don't come back lying to us, telling us again the boy wanted to die. And what really irritates me when some of us happen to be black, would end up talking about, we agree with white folk.
Wow.
Black folk want to die. Well, listen to this one black man, I don't want to die. Don't have a desire to die. Not narcissistic. Not trying to destroy ourselves. What black want to do is to live.
Thank you,
look how we struggle to live. We're living better than we ever lived. Praise God, somebody wants to destroy us. We need to come against that as a community. God bless you. God smile on you. Let's make sure Brandon still lives. Amen?
Yeah.
You took his physical body, but blood, God knows you can't take his spirit.
Thank you.
There's an aroma going on in the spirit now. Everybody knows that Brandon wants to live. Can you hear her voice right now? Don't shoot. Don't shoot. Don't kill. Don't hurt my husband. Because
wow.
Brandon wants to live.
Featured in the Denver Right article is Candace Bailey, and she's going to come and give her remarks, and then we're going to transition and present those who have come to provide legal support for this family, but I want you to welcome first Candace Bailey to come to the platform at this time.
I wish I could say good morning, good afternoon, good day. I thought deeply about this conversation and what this would look like. I thought about 46 seconds. 46 seconds has been ringing through my body for more than a month now. I thought about how long we'd be standing in this room and how long that 46 seconds could just play on repeat. 46 seconds, 46 seconds. If one of us just took that 46 second mark and hit the floor, we would have been dropped long before this press conference ever began. There is not a day in this community, as a black woman who has black sons and daughters, that I am not concerned about an interaction with police. There is not a day that I am not concerned about my black husband having a run-in with police over something so simple. And I thought about Ebony and Brandon being married, having a spat, and how that was looked at as threatening in our community. And I sat back and I watched this narrative being built by DPD, by people who look just like me, coming on and saying this was suicide by cop. The narrative that continues to be drugged by media sources, the narrative that continues to be drugged by those who are running for political office, by those who are in control, or so they believe. I thought about the fact that it is a black chief of police in Denver, a brown chief of police in the city of Aurora. Leader is not the title that you are given. That is not the truth, and I do not see leadership in our community. We are the only state that has police accountability legislation, and it is a dog with no teeth.
My God.
It doesn't bark. It doesn't bite. There is nothing but a performative action, and I keep hearing about this consent decree in the city of Aurora. And oddly enough, the trial for Elijah McClain is beginning. They're going through the process of selecting a jury 4 years. 4 years after his brutal murder. I think our community has asked and we have begged and we have watched this for a very, very long time in our community. We have watched leaders step up, give all the same dictation that we're talking about now. Talk about the budgets that these cities have. If you look at a budget, as Dr. Calderon leaned into, if you look at a city's budget, you look at their priorities.
Yes.
Both DPD, APD supersede more than 50% of the community's budget.
Wow.
More than 50%. So policing has been put at this vernacular that we as the citizens have never ever seen, because I've never seen 50% of a budget go to the people who live in the community. And so as we begin talking about dollars and talking about blood and off the backs of my people, I want to bring this real full circle to get an overstanding, because we just can't get under it anymore. We've got to get above it. As we continue to supersede insurance policies in these cities, that bill comes back to the people who pay the taxes and live in this community. So we are paying by blood, by our babies, by our brothers, by our sisters. And then we get the bill in the mail and don't even comprehend it.
My God.
There is not a layer of accountability that has been shown in any one of these situations. We just watched a lady officer from APD get 8 months of house arrest for sitting back and watching another officer pistol whip a gentleman. 8 months of house arrest? Do you comprehend that the average carceral time for just being a bystander and watching is more than 12 years? That is the average sentence of someone who stands by and watch someone be feloniously assaulted in the state of Colorado. I think we talk about gun violence a lot. Gun violence happens with guns, and so that means even if you are a police officer, that is an act of gun violence on our community.
Wow.
I've been a white woman and a black woman my whole life because underneath this skin bag, I am a white woman. I was raised by white immigrants. And I can tell you something. I've been called an angry black woman. I'm an angry white woman. I am an angry white woman because my white woman knows the answer to everything in the room. And she knows what those backdoor conversations look like. My black woman, she wants to love. She wants to love Ebony Cole. And not under the circumstances that her husband was murdered in front of her children. I just want to love her. But my white woman is furious. Furious. Because there is this game that continues to be perpetuated off the backs of black and brown folks. And white people, you are fully aware. You are fully aware. You've been at all the white meetings just as I have. This must stop. And it must stop in your home.
That's it.
I will make the call to mothers once again. Mothers, we are the nurturer of all things on this planet. We are life givers. What you nurture will grow. If your husband is doing something inappropriate and your children are witnessing that, it is your responsibility. Your responsibility, I say it again. Because as we've watched video after video after video after video, there is one common denominator. They are calling for their mothers. I say to you, mothers, stand up. Our community cannot take anymore. And white women, do not believe that this is not at your doorstep. Just as the opioid crisis can crept into your medicine cabinet, murder is creeping into your home, whether you like it or not.
Wow.
If you stand for nothing, you will fall for everything. And a narrative must not guide the right things in humanity. We must stand in a way we never have before. Division has been done. It is time for multiplication. It is time to stop blaming a victim of murder. Murder. Once your life is taken, you have been murdered. This man did not complete suicide by cop. It took 46 seconds. 46 seconds for this man's life to be diminished back to dust. Power and control are running a game on us, and systemically we have fallen for it, and we believe that marching and crying is going to solve it, and it will not. We must get at the pocketbooks of those who think they are in power and control.
That's
when
right.
I said defund the police, yeah, it wasn't a game. We must demand less performative action and real impact. And that means we must look at those budgets of more than 50% of what our community says we need, because I have yet to see public safety and public health in any stretch of the imagination. We must call on our senators and legislators to begin to put teeth back into the dog, SB 20-217. It is beyond time for accountability. And if you are not angry, I challenge you today to find anger in your body, because when it is your child, we will stand with you as well.
I want to say thank you first to all of our advocates that have shown their support today. First to Senator Rhonda Fields, who's making it possible for us to come together in this space. We are appreciative of the city council persons that have been represented here, Chantel Lewis in particular. We are grateful for all the clergy persons that find themselves here in this space to support, and for the community advocates who have already spoken previously, who are continuing to demonstrate their support on this issue and for this family. With that said, we open with our acknowledgement of all the organizations, including the NAACP, and at this time, we're going to ask, before we transition and present our legal team, if Jeremiah Intep would come and give his remarks on behalf of the Denver NAACP.
Hello, my name is Jeremiah, and I'm here to represent the young blacks in our community. We protested, we picketed, we posted, we've danced, we've sang, we've done every avenue we can to highlight that our lives do matter, to highlight that, as the great bishop said, we want life. I was Senator Fields' legislative aide in the Senate for 4 years. We sat through committees, we sat through rulemakings, sometimes until midnight. We took every avenue, and we wanted to scream, but we didn't scream. We wanted to shout, but we didn't shout. We were told, be good, be good. There's a way to do this. Sit back, and we're going to do this formally. We passed a bill that the nation could not. Congress could not pass the law enforcement bill that we passed in Colorado. We all showed out, and we passed it. And weeks later, they had a young black girl, maybe with 12 years old, in a tiara on the streets. They told us the right way. If you only dressed a certain way, if you only talked a certain way, if you only had your hair a certain way, then you will escape the police violence. It is self-evident that that is a lie.
Wow, yeah.
That young man wanted to live. Young people were frustrated because we've done this so many times. We've seen this so many times, that's why a bunch of my young brothers and sisters have said, well, the police are gonna do what we're gonna do, so we can't show up. Well, I'm saying to my young people that you are the movement, and the movement needs you. Mm-hmm. We all need to show up. Mm-hmm. The last thing I wanna say is, I wanna acknowledge that we stand on the shoulders of our elders. Thank you all for teaching us and investing in us. I ask you to please continue to invest in the young people. Ask the young brother how he's doing. Ask the young sister how she's doing, even if you don't know him.
Yeah, right.
It matters. Your love matters.
Yes,
your attention matters for the overall common good of the black community. When was the last time you heard a leader talk about the common good of the black community? Mm. We've gotten so far that talking about the common good may sound corny or even irrelevant. Come on.
All right. Come on, young man.
So I'm gonna keep it black, and I'm gonna keep it brief. We need you to show up. We need you to keep showing up, and thank you all for being here.
Yes,
well said, Jeremiah Intep from the Denver NAACP. We want to say thank you and give a shout out to the president, Sandra Young, of the NAACP, who made it possible for him to be here to represent their organization. She's in recuperation right now, so we appreciate her support behind the scenes, and she's already been given over the last several weeks. With that being said, I want to transition, as we said, and present the legal team that has that was asked to represent Ebony and her family. They have the right to pursue any options and opportunities as may be available to them, and when they were contacted by this law firm, who's not from Colorado, but it was the intent for Ebony to secure representation. She had that conversation with them that led to other conversations in the state of Ohio, which also made it possible for them to confer with a family member close to me, my brother, Pastor Aaron Phillips of the Sure House Baptist Church in Ohio, who also practices law there. He gave them important information information about who to connect with here in the Denver community. So I'm going to ask him to come and he can present formally the law team that has come and assembled themselves to support Ebony Cole and her family.
Thank you, Pastor Dale. I'm going to first just, let's thank this coalition of leaders from Colorado. Thank you all for being here. Absolutely terrific. I thank God for, this is how we're used to responding. I happen to know the greatest preacher and pastor ever, God ever made, happens to live in Denver, Colorado. His name is Bishop Asen Phillips. He's happy to know that now. And you call him with, there's a community problem, he's going to respond appropriately. We really appreciate you, Bishop, and thank God for all of you who are here today. Amen. I really appreciate that.
Amen. All of you.
And let me just say this, and then I'm going to still let you know who's coming. We have an epidemic problem, and it's not just in Colorado. It's nationwide.
Yes. Right. Yeah.
So don't, there's no thing about this is Cleveland, this is Denver, this is that. We have a problem academically nationwide.
That's right.
With
yes.
White people, white police people shooting black people.
True.
Men and women.
True.
Who are unarmed.
True.
So wherever there is a crisis,
yes.
We need to be able to respond. And we are putting, but what's really different about what we're doing, we're putting a coalition of people together across the nation. So when these things happen, because we do know that people respond locally all the time, but maybe we need to move that and be a national movement to what's happening right here in our communities. Because what has happened, what marching has done before, we have put people in position. But now we need transformation. And it's going to take all of us coming together from across this nation to get transformation.
Like
all right, so I'm going to introduce to you a very close, dear friend of mine. He is a fantastic lawyer, and I thank God for his leadership in this role. His name is Robert DiCello. Thank God for you. He's coming. He's representing this family, this beautiful family. And that's why we're here before this beautiful
yes,
family.
Yes.
Thank God for you. Come on up here, Robert.
So I am beyond humbled to stand with these two people. The problem with this case for the Denver police is both one of an object, a marker that can't be a knife, and objects who are the people standing next to me. The Denver police is not unlike most of the police departments that I face across this country, and I have cases all over the country. We just left Orlando yesterday on the arrest of a 6-year-old girl, African American. We did a press conference there. Now I'm doing this press conference for this family. And I will continue to fight across this country for my clients. But they're not my clients. Sitting next to me, on my right, is half of Brandon. How you doing? How old are you?
13.
He's 13. This is his example of his 13th year. We're yelling and hollering and upset and pained, and we have warriors behind us and all around us who've been trying to keep him safe, and we'll continue to do that. And he's staring at these cameras with me. And I ask you to let me keep the calm tone, because this has been a traumatic and abusive experience for him. And so as the Denver police wonder, what are the damages in this case? This is one of the moments, guys. Right here. And I can't tell you what it feels like to hold the mother of this man in my left hand and hold him in my right.
Yes.
Because it hurts my guts to believe two things. That one, most of you think I'm here for the money, that's the lawyers especially. And number two, that these people were objects who made phone calls, and their father, husband deserved to die for the way he behaved. Did I tell you he was an epileptic? Did I tell you he had medical problems? That he was a human being who had a dream to have a home, to raise this boy sitting next to me?
Yeah.
That he has a wife that loves him, and they fought, they had arguments. She did not get dumped out of her wheelchair by him. There was no big fight. Let's eliminate that too. And I can't repeat the allegation without sickening nausea rising in my throat over the notion that he wanted to die that day.
That's crazy.
When you repeat those words, or if anyone watching this program repeats those words, you're saying them to the young man on my right. He's 13 years old.
Yes.
So if you don't care about violence, if you don't care about people, if you don't care about anything, please try, as you watch this right now, to care about you. If you have a view of how other people behave and how they should behave, think of him.
Yes.
How is he going to behave?
Yes.
How is he going to move through this world? My job as his lawyer is to make sure that he has every single thing he needs to get through it as comfortably as humanly possible. Because justice is nothing but the story of dignity lost and returned. And I intend to return the dignity of these people. These are people. Return the dignity that was taken from them when the police department took their loved one. Thank you.
Well said.
I just also want to introduce who's with me here, Joe Fouché III, who's with me. He's part of our legal team and will be working this case with us. We have an extensive team. I can take questions about that later, but I thought it would be more appropriate right now if we just focused on the family. Thank you.
Well, again, as we wrap this up, we want to say thank you again to the community who's present here today. Also appreciation for all of the media who is present to help capture this story. Our hope, as we said at the outset, is that we will continue to frame the focal point of this story centered around support for this family. And we are praying with them continually and asking that others in our community would also continue to keep them in your prayers, as well as providing your support as a one family in our community. That'll bring the press conference itself to a formal end. And if there are any questions that you want to address to representatives who are standing here on behalf of the family, we'll give you that opportunity to do so at this time. Brother Jeff.
Following the murder of Paul Childs, we gained an independent monitor. We learned all about the things that could have been done, or all of that, which leads us to the STAR program. What happened? Wasn't the STAR program supposed to prevent exactly what we're facing today? How did the STAR program play into this or not?
I'm going to ask if Dr. Calderon would come and give us a response.
Professor Holmes knows about that too.
Go ahead, Lisa, you can go first.
You're right, Brother Jeff, that with the murder of Paul Childs, we gained an office of the Independent Monitor, so I want to remind people that that office was paid for with the blood of a black child. We can't ever forget that.
That's right.
The STAR program is an offshoot of all of that work since that time, and the critique from the community has been that they have not been involved after creating it, co-creating it together, but have been denied access at the table in where it's going. So what happens often is that we have great community initiatives that become co-opted by the system, which is another reason why we need an Office of Neighborhood Safety, so that the community can drive the solutions. But that is a fundamental question. We have STAR, we have LEAD, we have other acronyms for other responses that are not supposed to lead with policing first. And yet, as has been pointed out here time and time again, 46 seconds doesn't give you a time to de-escalate somebody, to talk to somebody, to see what's going on with them. So if we're going, if police leaders are going to take credit for STAR, which was a community program, and then when we need it, are nowhere to be found with where that program was, that is also a question for leadership.
Dr. Calderon is completely correct. I think Dr. Phillips touched upon it when he was up here and said when Paul was murdered, the city had a great response, Brother Jeff. They came to the Ministerial Alliance. I was the president at the time.
with resources. Those resources and the support lasted 1 year, and it was taken away from FACEIT, Family Advocacy Crisis Education Intervention Team. That was the nonprofit that I started. We worked on comparable discipline. Eventually, comparable discipline was qualified immunity, got rid of all of that. But the issue with the STAR program and with the subsequent programs after Paul Childs was that they didn't give the community any resources. They gave us 1 year, and then they developed an office, and there was a person in that office, Regina Herder, who sort of took command of the resources that were supposed to come to our community. And it went for 20 years. FACEIT is now a part of the STAR program, but FACEIT started the STAR program. The STAR program was designed to take troublesome 911 calls, refer them to clinicians, refer them to clergy persons, because they didn't need a police response.
Right.
And that's what STAR is about now. All of the 911 calls that are being made do not need a police response. But until they put resources into the community consistently,
yes,
consistently, to do that after, and I'm being a bit selfish, after I came up with the idea that let's work with the department,
yeah,
because we all need to face up to the fact that it's no one entity, it's all of us that need to work together. And so the STAR program now is sort of an offshoot of that, but we don't know how long they're gonna be supporting us to do it. We're serving black and brown people for the most part, but we know that that doesn't last very, very long. So you're right in your question. The STAR program is meant to deal with these kinds of calls in which police really should not be responding. It should be clergy and clinicians.
Yeah. How's this? So with that in mind, what would be appropriate response then to a call like this? Either Dr. Calderon or anyone.
Dr. Calderon, you can go first if you like.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
So one of my roles currently is to train law enforcement, I have a long history of doing that, on recognizing trauma from folks. So we need not just trauma-informed or healing-informed care, we need culturally responsive care as well. And so those things often are treated separately if they're treated at all. And you know, de-escalation really is a skill. And it takes some time. 46 seconds wasn't de-escalation. Calling someone's name when you are in uniform with a gun pointed at you is not de-escalation. So we need people from our communities who know how to handle and recognize the signs and symptoms of mental distress.
Right.
Because even just for the sake of argument, if I if I had suicidal ideation, that doesn't mean it is a cop's responsibility to kill me.
Come on,
right? So those are the situations in which you should be even protecting me from myself, and you don't do it by shooting me.
One of the things that we did when Paul Childs was murdered, there were only five officers on the Denver Police Department who had gone through something called CIT training. That's crisis intervention training. When we finished the whole department, I believe it was close to 85% had been trained in crisis intervention training. I think there needs to be a revisiting of that, because perhaps this was one of those cases. And with the STAR program, 911 operators are trained to be able to identify which calls actually should go to police and which calls should go to STAR. So I don't want us to just completely discard training. I think training is still necessary. There needs to be some revisiting of some issues around crisis intervention training, as Dr. Calderon said, so that officers can really recognize the purpose of CIT is so that officers can recognize the myriad forms of mental health, mental illness, and right now they need to revisit that. And I think people like Dr. Calderon and other community people who can assist them in that need to be a part of that. And I think that goes to her concern about the issue of having a neighborhood office in which those things can come out.
Let me respond to that too. One of the reasons that I have attached myself to this particular law firm is because when they file these suits on behalf of the family, they also want to provide community solutions. One of those community solutions is making sure we have mental health people responding. We will actually make that demand when we talking to the powers that be regarding that. And also, I wanted to, the attorney wanted to make a comment about the need to how to de-escalate properly as well.
We're going to rephrase this in a way that doesn't touch on the litigation too much, but I want to thank Dr. Calderon for her tremendous insight that 46 seconds is not de-escalation. And I want you all to remember, there was not a gun only pointed at him. There was a taser. And last I checked, you don't bring a taser to a lethal fight. So one officer saw no lethal threat and he was going to use a taser. Why did the other go for her gun? There's inconsistencies all around this defense that was manufactured after the death of my client. One of those inconsistencies is that he posed a lethal threat. The invention of the marker becoming some kind of knife is also, as we saw earlier, and it was a brilliant display, ridiculous. On its face, it's ridiculous. And so de-escalation is a skill. That's a perfect way to say it. It is a skill. It needs to be emphasized. It needs to be prioritized. And officers who witness no de-escalation have to have a way of venting that, reporting that, without themselves fearing they're going to get hurt in the field as well. Because one of the things about the thin blue line is that it's not very thin. It's actually huge. It's thick. It's super deep, and it's super dangerous. The line hides when officers do not de-escalate. So you can have all, it was Bishop who said this, rules are for rule followers. Accountability is going to have to come in court. We're going to have to expose the fact that they're not auditing these events. They're not reviewing these events. They're not reviewing and auditing their daily uses of force in a way that we think could be credibly said to support the escalation.
Well said.
All right, do we have any other questions from our meeting?
Great. Well, I'm interested, unless anybody else has anything. Mr. DiCello, I'll ask you a couple of, what are some of the inconsistencies that the police have presented in this hearing? You talked about the wheelchair argument. Like, what are the issues with the police story about what happened here?
Yeah, well, certainly, as I'm hearing behind you, as you're talking to me, I've got people behind me saying, don't give up the case. That's kind of like asking the coach of the Denver Broncos, what are your plays? I can't get into that too much, but what I will say is what's evident in the video should tell the tale quite clearly, that there are two officers responding, and let's talk a minute about this thing called cultural sensitivity training or cultural orientation training. This is a real solution. Okay, we've seen it working in different states, different cases that I've been involved in. We've worked to get cultural awareness because people speak, act, eat, dress differently under times of stress. And they don't become monsters, they don't become suicide wishers, they don't become evil because of those differences. And especially when you have the kinds of physical problems that my client was dealing with that day. If you've known anybody with epilepsy, then you know something about seizures. And I can tell you that you have not heard the full story about his medical state that day. I can tell you, and I can't get into it, and I won't, but because that'll be for the court, but I promise you, this was not a case of some evil guy beating his wife and then getting shot because he wanted to hurt himself or someone else.
That's right.
That is not what happened. I wouldn't be here if it was, and these folks wouldn't be here if it was. However, they might still be here because of the use of deadly force that was not necessary.
That's right.
I mean, understand, when the government takes a life, just takes a life. I love that statement that was made by Reverend Dell a minute ago. This is about life, the loss of life. Did they lower the flag even a notch? Did they lower it even 1 foot? Just in recognition of a citizen of this state, of this city, of this country, losing his life to the government. Secondly, does anybody in the state of Denver take at face value what the government says when it does take a life? How about when it sets your budget? How about when it sets your speed limit? Do you just take it at face value? No. And so it's peculiar, isn't it, that some of us take at face value the loss of life when it comes from police. That's something that we all have to look inside our hearts and see, why are we listening in that way? Why are we who lead others too? I'm aware of leaders in this community who are advocating that we do not gather today, that we do not speak today. Why? Because the police said. Think about that. And I'll tell you why. It's a whole lot scarier to think that your police department could kill or hurt you than it is to believe why they killed someone else.
Just a follow-up for the attorney. And I have to say my heart breaks for the family and community.
Yes.
Because this trauma is going to be generational. It's not something we just get over.
Right.
But succinctly, from your vantage point, the question is, why is Brandon Cole dead? Why is Brandon Cole dead?
There was a completely senseless use of force that was lethal.
Great question.
Period.
Great question.
Completely senseless use of, it was born out of fear. Everyone in law enforcement knows that officer was afraid of him.
And if Brandon were a white man, do you believe he would be alive today?
Yes.
Absolutely. No doubt about it.
Is that the same
thing? Yes. Absolutely.
And can I just add from the research perspective? So I'm also a criminal justice professor, as you know, for my job. Research also shows what you're saying. I would ask folks to get familiar with the research of Dr. Philip Goff and Dr. Tracy Cassie, who's local, former commander chief with the Denver Police Department, division chief. Tamir Rice, I think many of us remember that 11-year-old child and officer, white officer.
Cleveland, Ohio.
Right? There you go.
Cleveland, Ohio.
Killed him within seconds.
Absolutely.
Of arriving to the scene.
Roll right up on.
Well,
and so,
that's right.
Dr. Philip Goff, a black researcher,
yes,
wanted to know how on earth could that happen. And what he found was that white officers tend to look at black children as older and bigger and more threatening than they actually are. That white officer thought that child was a man. And so imagine when we do have a black man in distress, and you have a white officer fearing more for her safety than for his safety, seeing him more as a threat than those of us looking at him seeing someone from our community in distress. So research does prove that out.
I would add, just for those of you who are into the research piece of this, our firm has been working with Philip Atiba Goff on this matter and other matters, and we intend to use his insights, as we just heard, the scholarly work he's been doing and that Ms. Calderon's been doing. All of these things are extremely important to making some meaningful solutions.
And how can we support the family? How can we be supportive of the family?
So we need to make sure verbally, or even those who are present right now, verbally, let them know that you're here. You're standing with them. I know they see you physically, but they need to hear our support verbally.
Yes.
For those that are able,
yes,
to go beyond just the verbal and to say, what can I do to assist you? You don't have to, you know, wait till some special group here is gonna, you know, come up with a special fund. This, when family is hurting, we should be able to approach family members and say, what can I do to help you? And the third thing, we want to make sure that we secure this, Brother Jeff, and for everyone else, because it is unfortunate, but they may not be getting that kind of support from everyone. But you know what? We don't have to have everyone.
That's right.
But if we get someone, and if you turn out to be that someone, all that we're doing is letting Ebony and her family know that you are not standing alone.
That's right. Amen.
Thank you all.
Bishop. Go ahead, Bishop.
Thank you so much for talking with me just this last time. It's so important what Pastor Dale just said. Sometimes while we're fighting, the family's still suffering.
That's right. Absolutely.
This family does, in fact, need your help right now. They don't have time to wait till the end of the lawsuit to find out what they might get from the city and the state. It's amazing how even with the one we got in court right now, in Aurora, that mother was homeless while they were fighting her case and had to come back to the Ministerial Alliance. I'm a founder of the Ministerial Alliance. But remember, for 60-something years, it's important that preacher and patient work together. We've got to put the street and the church back together. You cannot divide us from us. And it's amazing how you take somebody else's narrative when you've not spoken to this family. I was at the funeral with her. She needs help. She needs to be loved right now.
Right.
And I'm going to convince all I can do personally. I'm going to ask you to do the same thing. Don't be waiting on a date. We have to do something now. But the narrative that's out there has to change. And what we do going forward, you heard all of these things we put into place. Worked hard to do. None of them got any teeth. All kind of laws passed. But lawbreakers keep breaking laws. Right now, we got policemen in the streets in blue uniform breaking laws. And they were committed to the uniform than they are the individual. We must come together and stay together. All of us in this black house, black folk, you belong in one house. Got a whole lot of different rooms. Everybody can have a room for the room you run. But there got to be some house rules where we don't divide ourselves from ourselves. We cannot afford to have black folk who would work hard to get you inside, sitting at the table. We always talk about us being on the menu after you sitting at the table. That's ridiculous. Some things don't need to be marched for. We need to go inside, sit at the table we created, and learn how to chair that table. Politicians have to make sure you pass the law, but the community has to make sure they obey the law. Right now, the person disobeying the law is the one supposed to protect the law. And you can't give them a pass because they're wearing a blue uniform.
That's right.
Can't do that. You got to call it what it is. Brian was murdered by a white policeman who was really afraid, not of a pen, afraid of his black face. Don't forget that he was killed because he was black. If he was white, you heard it over, it would not have happened. We've got to tell folk how to change the minds of the way we think about black folk. You can't keep thinking every time you see somebody black, that's something evil.
Wow.
That goes way back. Good guys wear white hats, bad guys wear a black hat. That's not true. You can have all kind of white hats on and be as evil as you want to be. We have to make sure we stand up and tell folk, respect us, as black folk. If you learn how to respect us, eventually you might learn how to love us.
Wow.
We've loved you for a long time. You've been dead in your grave. If black folk hadn't loved you while we were still slaves, could have put some armies in your cornbread, you wouldn't be here. Stuff your child out with a pillow. We did not do that. Black folk love folk continually, and we're trying to get you to learn how to love us. We chased you all over time, trying to integrate. And you thought we came because you had something we needed. We were trying to share with you what we had. You need to learn how to love yourself. Every morning I get up and look in the mirror, I see a beautiful black man and I love him. And I tell myself every day, my God, you were good when you designed me. I'm black and I'm good looking. And we need to keep saying it to ourselves. And white folk, you need to understand. We're not afraid of being black, not ashamed of being
black.
Yeah. You got to learn to love us while we're back, because we're not going to change our color.
One of the things we would like to do, even though this is a press conference, we are clergy led, so I'm going to ask us to center around as family, and that Pastor Dale would come and lead us, and Pastor Holmes would lead us in a prayer for this family. Today, that's how we're going to close this press conference. We do believe that the church is responsible in these times to lead this effort. Every civil rights organization and movement was led through the instrument of the church, and we believe in that even still now. That's why when we wanted to connect with certain clergy here in the city of Denver and as well as across the country today. So continue to stand with us. One of the other things you can help us do is tell Brandon Cole's story the right way. When you tell that story on your social media, you can repost this on social media. Let people know the narrative that has been given. There's more to the story. So put that out there in the atmosphere, Brother Jeff. That
yes,
there's
sir.
There's another side of the story that needs to be told.
Thank you.
And just thank you, Pastor Holmes, for being with us as clergy.
Yes, we do.
And thank you for all the activists. I don't see Candace here, the folks from the NAACP, the Alliance. Oh, thank you all very much, Dr. Calderon. And thank you for this legal team who helped support put this all together. We really appreciate, these are lawyers who care about Brandon Cole. He's not just another number, his name is Brandon Cole.
Amen.
And he has a family, and we support you. Pastor Dale.
Father God, we come together in agreement as men and women of faith, men and women who know when we cannot handle issues that we wrestle with in our life, we turn our attention as well as our hope towards you. And God, we're praying right now as our arms and hands are stretched out,
yes, God,
to connect with this family. God, we pray for Ebony, her
yes,
children,
God,
the entire family. Asking now, God, in this moment, that as they see us physically coming together, that they will see this as a greater witness of your presence always being with them. God, more than anything, they simply need to know that they are not alone, that you are always present, never absent. And God, I pray, we pray for their comfort and for their peace as they continue to have to process emotionally
yes,
the loss
yes,
of the head of this family, of
yes,
this household. God, we pray that as they are comforted by your presence, we pray also, God, for your provision for them emotionally, spiritually,
yes,
and materially,
yes,
God.
Yes,
that
yes,
all things that they need to make them strong, all things that they need to make them whole, God, we are trusting that not parts of their life, but
yes,
all of their life
yes,
is in your hand.
Thank you, God.
And in your hand,
your hand
God,
your
you
hand
will make them whole.
Thank
this we pray
God,
and believe
yes,
in the name of Christ Jesus. And in agreement we say.
Yes,
amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, God.
Thank you all for
coming.
Is there anything your clients would like to say?
No, not at this time.